Missouri makes its traditional Tiger walk on homecoming Saturday here in Columbia. Their new quarterback, Blaine Gabbert, faces his biggest challenge of the season against Texas. Colt McCoy is determined to put the critics in his rearview mirror tonight and lead the Longhorns to their seventh straight win on Saturday Night Football. You are looking live at a sold-out Memorial Stadium in Columbia, Missouri, where Texas continues its quest for a BCS championship on Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. Well, the Horns are 6-0 for a second straight season. Tonight they face a young Missouri Tiger team looking for a homecoming upset against a number 3 team in the nation. And with an impressive win here tonight, the Horns could well be the number 2 team when we come to you next week. That's because Alabama survived a major scare at the hands of Tennessee, and Bama had to block a field goal as time ran out, and they preserved their unbeaten season. Good evening. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for dropping by with Kirk Street. I'm Brett Musburger. You know, we saw that shot of Colt McCoy and all the criticism and not living up to last year and blah, blah, blah. What do we make of all this?
Well, Colt McCoy's still a winner, and I think this offense is still growing around him. You know, last week against Oklahoma, there was some concern this week how he would react to this play. Gerald McCoy right in front of him, the All-American, as he comes through there, his right hand and McCoy collide. It affected him a little bit on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday, but he's had a great week of practice. But there's the look from last year to this year. His numbers are down. Last year, he finished second to Heisman. This year, he's still waiting to have his breakout year. I mean, I will say this. Texas has made some adjustments tonight. You're going to see Marquise Goodwin step into the lineup tonight, a young freshman receiver. Malcolm Williams will come in. I think all this is to help Colt McCoy and also take some of the pressure off of Jordan Shipley to try to get this offense going. But I think it's more than Colt McCoy. I think it's the players around Colt that need to get better starting tonight.
And we got an injury on the other side, too. Blaine Gabbert, the new quarterback here at Missouri, ankle injury in the first quarter against Nebraska.
Yeah, a couple games ago against Nebraska. He's been a different quarterback ever since the injury. In fact, this entire offense is change from this game because of this injury or because of the competition in the Big 12. But nonetheless, they feel that Gabbert is healthy. He's had a great week of practice. They feel that he's much healthier this week than he was last week when they played against Oklahoma State. And not only is Blaine Gabbert important tonight in his ability to throw the football downfield against Texas, but his athletic ability. He's very fast for his size. He could hurt the Longhorn defense by running and creating, and we'll see if his ankle can hold up to be allow him to do that.
Well, one thing is for sure, Irby, when you and I were down on the field for the pregame warm-ups, there is no doubt that Colt McCoy is fired up.
There's no help from the very beginning. Let's go. Come on.
They want it from the very beginning. As you look at the famous 6 columns, all that are left down to the original building here. We welcome you back to Columbia, Missouri. Another important stop along the drive to the national championship. But tonight, here in Columbia, Texas, hopes to put it in overdrive on the road. Lisa Salters, what are you finding out down below?
Well, Brent, Colt McCoy told me earlier that thumb is still sore, but getting better. Earlier in the week, there was a lot of swelling there, and McCoy was concerned that he might have trouble tonight handling the ball. But after a week's worth of treatment, the swelling has since gone down, and right now he's saying that he's having no problems at all throwing. That thumb certainly did not stop McCoy from making what he says was the play of the year last weekend. Remember that interception that he threw late? McCoy told me, "I made my best play of the game right after that when I made that tackle." He said, "Hey, it was just me and him. We were in an empty backfield, and they had blockers." And, guys, that is something to think about. If Oklahoma had scored, had gone on, held on to win the game, Texas's national championship hopes could have gone down the drain. So right now, maybe that is the play of the year for the Longhorns. Guys?
Yeah, good point, Lisa. And Mack Brown, of course, in talking with the media and defending his quarterback's Heisman Trophy chances, hey, look, fellas, he hasn't missed a tackle all season. And, of course, on the other side, and the only blemish on Gary Pinkel's coaching record here is the fact that he has not been able to beat either Texas or Oklahoma since he became the head coach. But he has done an outstanding job putting the program back together here at Missouri, winning bowl games, winning the North Division, everything else. And oh, how Missouri would love to upset the Horns here tonight. Sellout crowd on this homecoming Saturday. Tanner Mills will kick it away. DJ Monroe fielded at the 9-yard line by DJ. Got the right edge. It spins out to about the 39. So Colt McCoy comes out, and Herbie gave you the statistical comparison between this and last year, and he's looking for a big game tonight.
I think a big thing the Colts started to do last week against Oklahoma for the first time all year is they actually used him. He was running the football a lot more. In fact, 14 different times they used him, and I think Mack Brown and Greg Davis feel you'll see more of that tonight as this offense continues to evolve this year.
Fozzie Whitaker, number 28, had a big game against Oklahoma. Play fake, first down pass, drops it off to his roommate Shipley on a first and 10 and still going. And he's to the 29-yard line on the first play of the game, McCoy to Shipley.
Well, you can bet Dave Steckel, the defensive coordinator from Missouri all week long, said we have to keep an eye on number 8 in white, put 2, sometimes 3 defenders. The last thing Missouri wanted to happen early in this game is for Colt McCoy and Jordan Shipley to find rhythm. And here they get started with the first play of the game.
For 31 yards. Here comes Whitaker on a cutback run. I believe he was down already, but the linesman said the ball is down.
Stop by Smith for Mizzou.
And Fozzie certainly appeared to be on the ground before the football came loose.
Brent, yeah, you're all over it. He's down, and then the ball comes down well after he is on the turf. But if you have not seen a lot of Texas the last few years, this is what you see a lot in the Big 12, the hurry-up Colt McCoy with the fastball here, getting this team up to the line of scrimmage.
Coming back with 28 again, and he stopped short of the first down, and you will see number 12 in that pile somewhere, I guarantee. Sean Witherspoon is around every tackle.
Absolutely. And Jordan Shipley, you've already seen, so important to Colt McCoy, and I think he brings a lot of attention to himself. It could open the door for Marquise Goodwin, making his first career start as a freshman, had a big game last week, has great speed. And there's Fozzie Whitaker. The coaches have felt the last 2 years he's their most talented running back, and now that he's healthy, he takes over there in the backfield.
Now, Cody Johnson, the short yardage back, has checked in behind Houston here on this third down. So the power eye, Houston will lead the way. Johnson for the first down. Whitaker is being held back on the sideline.
How about Jasper Simmons, the safety, number 9, is in position here, right there, to make the play. But next thing you know, not only Lamar Houston blocking, but Cody Johnson went right over top of number 9, Jasper Simmons, to pick up that first down.
And that earns Cody Johnson a first down. He's in the backfield. Fozzie's still on the sideline.
beautiful hitch route out here to Williams on the outside. Malcolm Williams playing tonight along with Marquise Goodwin. As Herbie told you, that they have adjusted and Mac has gone looking for some playmakers on the edge, looking a little bit down the road. Wants this young man, the track star, to step out and be a go-to weapon.
And the ball came out here. This one actually did come out, it looked like, right before his knee touched, but it rolled out of bounds.
They come back with the big back. Johnson pounding another first down and still going. Looking a little bit like the legendary Earl Campbell. Now, I don't want to put that on it, because if you ever watched Big Earl play for the Horns and later in the NFL, you were talking about one of the most powerful backs in the country.
Well, speaking of power, right now the Texas offensive line showing some power, really picking up where they left off in this opening drive against Oklahoma, the way they ended that game in the second half in a very physical game with 102 yards in that second half, right now taking control of the line of scrimmage.
Maybe looking for Fozzie on the edge this time. He's back on the field. Play fake to him. Colts going to keep it, and it'll be second down. So Will Ebner, who's on the field right now, number 32, made the play.
Brent, this is one of the adjustments that Texas used last week. A lot of misdirection and trying to confuse a to pick up Ebner as he slipped through there and got penetration.
Second and goal, drops it off to Shipley, and there's your money man tonight. Shipley carries it in. The first touchdown of the night, and number 8, Colt McCoy's roommate. And so McCoy throws his first touchdown of the night, and is to Shipley.
Look at the cushion that Jordan Shipley has here. Down in that area, you have to be able to walk your secondary up on Jordan Shipley and challenge him off the line of scrimmage, because the first guy that Colt McCoy is going to look for almost every time, let alone in the red zone, is Jordan Shipley. You don't walk somebody up to the line of scrimmage, that's an easy throw.
And he holds the extra point for Hunter Lawrence, who tacks it on. And just like that, folks, remember, style points are in play tonight for the Horns. They don't want to win. They want to win big. They know every man. Jordan Shipley having a big season, scraped his right forearm being tended to, Herbie.
Here's Kendra Jackson, a safety, walked off a good 8 to 10 yards. Look how easy it is for Shipley to get the release to the outside. And with Colt McCoy and Jordan Shipley, they work so well together. If you're not going to challenge Shipley off the line, that is, again, pitch and catch for those two.
Justin Tucker hangs the kickoff high. It is fielded at the 8-yard line by Simmons. Simmons thrown out of bounds over there on that side by Earl Thomas. Let's check in with Matt Weiner in New York. We're back in Blaine Gabbert back there in the gun. You know, we'll be watching, and now there's a penalty flag early.
Ball start. Offense, number 66, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
And Herbie, the big issue with him is pushing off on the right foot. The coach is telling us that in Wednesday they had to face up with him and say, look, if you can't push through it, we may have to look for somebody else.
Yeah, and I mean, he has really shown a warrior mentality these last couple weeks playing through the pain.
You can see there's still a little hitch in that giddy up, and that is incomplete over there. Well, the tackle on the kickoff, a point I want to make, Herbie, about Earl Thomas, number 12. When we talk about the Nagurski Award, which is awarded by the Football Writers of America to the best defensive player in the country, and I know Bronco played defensive line, but if this goes to either a defensive lineman, a linebacker, or a defensive back, I'm going to tell you, he's one of the leading candidates. What a breakout season that young man has had in second year forever.
Only a sophomore.
Kendall, stand-up rush in, number 2, forces the play, makes the stop. And there is another candidate for the Nagurski.
This Missouri football team, Brent, this is very, very important part of this game, even though it's early. It's a team that lost big to Texas last year in Austin. The game got taken away from them right away. They came into this game thinking they needed success early. Texas goes right down and scores, asserts themselves. Blaine Gabbert in Missouri needs to try to counter here. Now it's going to be that much tougher on third and long.
Look how they spread the field. Here comes a late blitz. And Gabbert is in deep trouble. So they came and adjusted their personnel, and they never saw him coming. And he is playing with that injured ankle, and he has been shaken up, just like the Horns got to Sam Bradford early. Now they get to Gabbert.
Gabbert's going to face some pressure. It's going to come from his left. Actually, Deion Beasley comes late. Give Will Muschamp again all the credit here. The defense really starting to understand what Muschamp wants. They disguise it perfectly, wait until the last second, create the confusion up front, and Gabbert doesn't have anything to do but to eat the football.
There's the punt. It puts it right back in Shipley's hands. Nothing doing. Just fabulous coverage on that punt. Carl Geddes able to get downfield, the cornerback, and make the stop. And there's a young man with a big heart, but an injured right ankle. We've got timeout. Yeah. On this night, we'll give Missouri football. Here comes McCoy. With a screen and Red Shipley getting nothing doing, and Ebner will replace the injured Lambert early. Makes a big time hit.
Good job this time by Ebner of reading this, and maybe they're making the adjustment to come right down. Anytime you're going to see Jordan Shipley get that football, there should be two or three black jerseys surrounding him. Remember, again, the thing to do is force Colt McCoy to find others to make plays.
For wide for the Horns. Buckner in that flex position gets a short pass and no gain. Hit almost immediately by Ebner again, the sophomore from Texas.
Right now, Will Ebner is all over this field as a sophomore, making a lot of plays. He had a big hit on that first drive, this time a couple plays in space, and that's the important thing, is you can't allow Texas, after the catch, to make a lot of yards. And as I said, third down, you got to believe, look for number eight to take him away and see who else can make a play here.
Split far out to the left is number 84, Goodwin. Looking back to the middle, and that's short, with Shipley short of the first down. And this is fourth down. Witherspoon had the stop for the Tigers. What an outstanding linebacker, Sean Witherspoon. Another one from Texas. And did Colt get shaken up here?
Yeah, after the throw. And again, he's waiting on Jordan Shipley to clear, but the young freshman, Alden Smith, puts the pressure on him as he throws the football. One of the first times they've been able to apply some pressure on Colt McCoy as he has dropped back to throw.
Remember, Oklahoma had him on the ground in Dallas 14 times in the first half. And the fake punt. So they were in a short yardage situation. They pick it up on the fake. And if you want a style point, here's one.
I was just about to say what a big stop that was for Missouri to be able to get Texas to punt the way this game started. But Mack Brown saying, guys, we came into this game, we're going to be aggressive. I'm going to coach aggressive. We're going to play aggressive. Sending a message to his team and not just picking up that first down.
Antoine Cobb, one of the fullbacks, carried the ball as an up-back situation. And now they come back to pound with Cody Johnson working away at this defensive line.
You know, Mack Brown often gets looked at as a guy who's, you know, he's classy, doesn't want to embarrass the other team. But you know what? Here's Mack Brown early in a game trying to assert himself and his team's will on the Missouri football team on the road. I love the call here and the guts to make that call at midfield.
Williams, first down. So again, it was very soft, and he crosses the 30-yard line.
If you're going to continue to be soft on these Texas receivers, they're going to make you pay for it. Geddes this time against Malcolm Williams. Here's one of the young men who's been inserted to make a difference. If you spend too much time on Shipley, Goodwin 84 and Malcolm Williams, both making starts tonight, have to be able to step up and make plays. And Williams, you can see the acceleration there for a big man after that catch.
Chris Hall, the senior center from Irving, Texas, snaps it and leads the pull for Johnson. And Johnson gets close to still another first down. And Dominique Hamilton, the sophomore from El Paso, making the stop. When you look at this Missouri roster, You see a lot of Texas youngsters up there. To give you an update on Colt McCoy tonight, 7-of-7 as he hands it off to Johnson. Johnson battling, but he's short of the first downing. It will be 3rd and short. McCoy 7-of-7 for 72 yards and a touchdown here in the early going.
It's early in this game, but I think you could even see in the warm-ups before the game, our cameras caught him, you and I down there watching his body language. Colt McCoy looked like the old Colt McCoy tonight. Jumping around, smacking guys, feeling good before this game got started. You could tell that he's not concerned. This looks like the first time we've seen him. He's not concerned about all the expectations and the hype. He's just trying to play football tonight.
Johnson's behind Houston. Houston, the defensive lineman. And they're going to roll and throw out of that formation. He's going to keep it for an easy first down. And he steps out at the 10-yard line.
Now the defensive end and the linebackers lost contain, committing down to take the inside runaway. Jacquees Smith came down. He lost contain, and now it's a little bit of a cat and mouse game for Colt McCoy. He can either take the run or he can wait for them to bait and come up and then throw for the touchdown. He picks up big yards with his legs.
Mazi Whittaker checks back in. And 5-step to the outside. 10-5. And appeared to be just short. Touchdown is the signal on the field, so he must have got the pylon. I thought for a second from up here that he was going to be just short. But let's watch the end of this play now. Keep a very close eye on Fozzy reaching out. And the official ruling, he hit it before he's out of bounds.
Looks like he was still airborne. The left hand, the pylon. Yeah, I think he did get the pylon before the left hand touched out of bounds.
The official standing right there. So Lawrence is back on the field. Remember what led to this? And that was the fake punt on 4th and short. So Mack Brown leading the way with that call. And Texas goes out early by 14.
We're Texas, just north of Mexico, home of the armadillo.
What is that?
It's just freestyling.
We don't freestyle Texas fight, big boy.
ESPN College.
Beautiful scene here, Herbie.
Absolutely. Right now they're fairly quiet, but the blitz comes right here from Gooden. When he comes around, watch the block right here. They actually pull the guard and the tackle around, and when you do that, it allows Fozzy Whittaker to get in sync. The guard comes around there, right there, Huey, and Kyle Hicks picks up another big block on the defensive end, and then Fozzy Whittaker's speed, but a real good feel by him, feeling the blitz, reading his blocks, and then getting to the pylon for the touchdown.
Tucker kicks it off Simmons at the 3-yard line. Bit of a crease. There's a penalty. They're going to lose some yards on this return. Well, Missouri coming out for its second possession here. Remember, they were 3 and out on their first one. So they're looking for their first down, and we'll let the Big 12 officiating crew sort this one out.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Return team number 10, half the distance to the goal. First down.
Tom Walker and Gary Pinkle jotting down still another mistake.
This is like Groundhog Day for Gary Pinkle right now. After the game last year in Austin, it's kind of like Groundhog Day for you and I and all of America watching these two teams play each other so far. They need something to change the momentum of this game, because right now their worst nightmare is happening right before their eyes.
And you know that defensive front, you know that front licking its chops. Changing up plenty of time. Snaps it off to Alexander. That's his go-to guy. And we've got a Matt Weiner in our Times Square studios in New York for that. And here, Texas out early. A 2-touchdown lead on Missouri. And that's their first down for the Tigers on that last play. Gabbert back in the gun. And hand hands it off on the inside, trying to get some semblance of a running game going. Devin Moore, who's back there with Washington, and Aaron Williams makes the tackle.
In this conference, there are so many different versions of the spread. And no matter what, Will Muschamp knows that one way to be able to defuse these spread attacks is to be able to have a defensive line that can get penetration and put pressure on a quarterback and defend the run with your front four. And if you can control the line of scrimmage, you can do a lot of different things.
Washington, the ball carrier. And not much of a gain is Keenan Robinson, number one. Medi.
He was telling me before the game that, you know, mixing up coverages was so key last week in defending Oklahoma, and it'll be key tonight. Mixing in some man, giving Blaine Gabbert as a young quarterback a lot of different looks, some zone, some zone blitz, just trying to confuse him and his offensive line. And he's very blessed right now to have a defense playing with a lot of confidence.
Third and 10 against pressure. He just didn't have any time at all. And so it will be fourth down. So after picking up a first down on their first play, it is now three and punting. And here comes Kendall.
Well, Texas is getting pressure. This is called affecting the quarterback. It's not a sack. Doesn't necessarily show up in the stats. But it's a great job by Texas making Gabbert get rid of the football before he wanted to.
Acho, number 81, came up the middle. That was Kendall pressing from the outside. That was Sam Acho, the junior. Of course, his brother is number 18, the manual. Left-footed punt again by Harry. And a fair catch by Shipley at about the 38-yard line. Well, two to brag about, the Washington Redskins. Now his first down and 10. And a little flare outside, and Whitaker is pushed out of bounds.
What do you make of what happened to Jim Zorn? I've never seen anything like that.
Don't you always reach back and call out somebody who's calling bingo numbers to come call plays for you? Doesn't it? I mean, the league's crazy. Didn't the
that
Raiders
franchise
reach back and get somebody who was a bed and breakfast to come and call plays? They'll be calling you.
Man, got to put the Raiders and the Redskins and get them together in another Super Bowl. That's
second down and 10. Whitaker started in one direction and handed back to 28. Smith making the stop, and let's go down below to Lisa.
Well, guys, I used it for the swine flu. He said, yes, I was. The test was negative. He says it's an upper respiratory problem, but I'm doing much better now, guys.
Here's on third down. Can't find anybody open. Stumbling. Got the first down. Salvaged what appeared to be a loss.
Brett, this is going to eventually catch up to Missouri. It already has earlier. It's third and three. And look at the coverage and the respect that Missouri has for the Texas speed. Now, Colt McCoy ends up improvising and making a play, but look at the bottom if he wanted to throw it to Whitaker. Almost all the receivers to the top and to the bottom are open because of that cushion. But Colt this time takes advantage of that athletic ability and picks up the first.
Greg Davis is going to whistle up a long pass sooner. And Whitaker to midfield on first down. And Brian Coulter, the senior from Louisiana, right there making the snap.
If you're Colt McCoy, you look into this secondary, and almost every snap, they're 8 to 10 to 12 yards off the line of scrimmage. If he wants to put the ball in the hands of a great athlete, pick a receiver and just throw it out there, and all you have to do is make one guy miss and dance around him to pick up 15 yards.
Second down and 9. McCoy is still perfect. 8 of 8. Here's can't find anybody open. Going to tuck it away again. And he was smashed that time. MetLife is providing these dramatic views of Memorial Stadium and of the University of Missouri campus. MetLife provides coverage of major sporting events while also providing you with guarantees for the ifs in your life. And folks, that was number 12. That was Sean Witherspoon unloading on McCoy. There is the number one defensive player on Missouri. And he himself is one of the Nagurski candidates here.
Defensive guys, credit.
Yeah, Heisman's for you, pretty boy.
Yeah, I hear you.
Come on. There's McCoy. There's the long pass whistled up, and they want interference, and they got it. There was no question that Shipley was interfered with. Geddes was the corner on that side. That'll be an automatic first down. You just knew once the horns got back to midfield,
they were going to go deep. Pass interference, defense, number 19, 15-yard penalty, first down.
And one of the reasons you're seeing Dave Steckel and Gary Pinkel elect to give them a cushion is, again, because of the respect they have for the ability of Texas to go right by their defensive backs. And that time, without him grabbing on to Shipley, Shipley made a move, surprised Geddes, and went right by him, and he had to hold on to the jersey just to hold up. Dave Steckel, the reason he's doing what he is doing is, like I said, he respects Texas and their big play ability, and he's just trying to keep everything in front of him.
James Kuykendall on the field, one of the wideouts. Three wide for the horns, and the running backs, Cody Johnson, and timeout called by McCoy.
Timeout.
And the horns as
Texas, first charge of the half.
Didn't understand the situation, and Max says, come on over here. And didn't want the penalty. Here we are in the first half.
The year Texas again, anytime it's about style points and winning isn't enough, you wonder what kind of mentality a team will show up with. I'll tell you, it's been a business trip. In the first quarter, Texas has impressed me with Mac Brown, his energy on the sidelines, that fake field or fake punt to keep that drive alive. I mean, they've really brought some energy into this football game today.
Missouri has not been in Texas territory yet here in the first quarter. Texas has touchdowns on its first two possessions, in case you're just dialing us in. This is the Horns' third possession of the night. They came in a two-touchdown favorite here tonight. And McCoy off a fake, wide open. Here comes Childs, converted quarterback for the touchdown. Three possessions and three touchdowns. John Childs goes 34 yards. That's two touchdown passes for a perfect Colt McCoy.
This is beautiful by Childs. He gets around, Geddes stays in bounds. What a throw by Colt McCoy. And Childs has the speed to make you pay for it. But the play action held the safety just long enough to give Colt McCoy a window there. So once Childs got around the corner, it was a throw and the safety was out of position because of the play action, and it's a touchdown.
And Lawrence tacks on point number 21. A quiet sellout crowd here at homecoming in Columbia. Colt McCoy and the Longhorns are putting on a show early. So welcome back to Columbia, Herbie, and it's now 21-0 Texas. Tucker kicks it off still again, and here comes Simmons. To give Missouri something to build on, and they're down on the 24-yard line. Let's go back to the TD.
Well, the ball fake is going to go this way, and Hardy Ricks right here, the safety, is going to bite just long enough, and Childs gets around the coverage. Watch the ball fake, hold the safety just for a second, and then once he gets around, look at the space behind Ricks, because he had to come up and appreciate Fozzie Whitaker potentially running the football, and that's why, for Texas fans, it's so important that Colt McCoy have that ally, the running game, to open up the play-action pass.
Four receivers to the left and one to the right. And Gabbert now hoping his offensive line can give him a little time. Quick hitch. Alexander again. Run out of bounds on the Texas side of the game by Earl Thomas, the sophomore from Orange, Texas, number 12.
If anybody's going to try to get Missouri back into this game, it's going to have to be Denario Alexander. He has had a breakout year, 6'5", 215 pounds, and he's a great story himself. The way he's battled back after three surgeries on his knee, he is an explosive player for the Tigers.
So the final seconds of the first quarter ticking away. Gabbert checking over on the Mizzou sideline. Last snap of the first quarter. And off the receiver, Derek Washington's hands, and incomplete. And I misspoke, we've still got a second left.
You see Derek Washington as a tailback split out to the outside there, and you see him drop a pass, and you think, oh, why is running back out there at receiver? They'll tell you he may have the best set of hands on this football team that time, just lost his concentration on second down and short.
Now three wideouts shifting. It's West Camp, number 8, far out to the right. Now everybody checking over to the sideline, and the play clock becomes a factor, and they've got to burn a timeout. Not what you want to see in this situation with a third and one. Coach Pinkel over on the Missouri sideline faces a huge uphill battle. And one point we can't make enough of, folks. Yes, Texas has its eyes squarely on Mizzou, but they've got their eyes squarely on Alabama tonight. You know the story. Alabama has gone past them. Well, Alabama survived a scare. They had a block, or I guess Tennessee missed one of three field goals tonight. Bama survived blocking a 44-yarder as time ran out in Tuscaloosa. They were favored against Tennessee, and the Volunteers played a very, very tough football game. The defensive coordinator, Lane Kiffin, has now done a great job with the Tennessee defense against both Florida and now Alabama. And ratings and style points are important to these teams at the top of the BCS rankings. Third down and one.
Right now, the reason there's confusion, they're trying to count how many defenders are in the box area. Texas trying to hide how many people they're committing to that box.
Screen to Alexander, who picks up the first down as time runs out on the opening quarter. So a first down. Missouri will have the ball when we come back with the second quarter. This presentation of Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines, will return after this message and word from our ABC stations.
Trying to get the rally caps on in here.
So Steve Stepanovich was the big fella on the right, and Sunvold, of course, was there on the left. Two basketball legends. Last year, Missouri made it to the Elite Eight before they were eliminated. Coach Anderson doing a fabulous job, and they lost their scores going into the season. They have a great backcourt, and they're in a tough conference. And here comes Devin Moore, and he's just short of putting the football into Texas territory for the first time here tonight. They have not yet been in Texas territory, but they figure to get there now.
Well, Moore that time finally had a little bit of room to run. It's a design cutback that got this aggressive Texas defense a little bit off balance and picks up some huge yards for the Tigers. Trying another yard and a half, they break into Texas territory.
Second down and three for Gabbard. Incomplete, still throwing high. And again, remember the inability to drive hard off that right ankle, something that has been bothering him since the first quarter against Nebraska. And meanwhile, I've been saying this evening that Texas has its eye on Alabama. They may also have their eye on Florida. The Gators are in a dogfight. It's 13-10 at the half. Florida in Starkville playing Mississippi State on ESPN. So we've got a couple of the heavyweights battling, and they've got different kind of games on their hands. Gabbard's under pressure from the backside, has to throw it away.
That was just to put it in perspective what Gabbard has dealt with that ankle. You know, in the first four games of the year, he completed 66% of his passes with 11 touchdowns and no interceptions. You can see as he's trying to avoid Acho coming in from behind in Houston in front that he's still favoring that right ankle. In the last two games, he's completed 44% of his passes with one touchdown and five interceptions. So a different guy with that ankle injury over the course of the last 2.5 games now.
And guess what? Mizzou did not make it into Texas territory, and now they will punt. So it's Harry on the field. Shipley, fair catch at the 12-yard line, and that's where Colt McCoy and Texas will have it for the fourth time tonight. The first three possessions, all touchdowns for the Longhorns. Ohio State won the 2003 Fiesta Bowl and the BCS title with a TD run by Maurice Claret in the second overtime. See play number 17 revealed next Saturday at 3:30 Eastern here on ABC. Colt McCoy was perfect in the first quarter. 9 of 9. A couple of touchdowns. Here's Goodwin. His first reception of the night, the speedster. And he picks up another first down. And now let's go to Matt Weiner back in New York. And here's Here we have another completion, a good one. They put him on the other side of the field for 9 more yards for Texas. So the number 3 team, the Horns, lead it here, Matt, 21-0.
Colt McCoy in these first 3 drives, along with this Texas offense, really doing about anything they want to do. They're executing at a different level, and this is kind of the expectation that I think many people had for Colt and this offense most of this year.
Johnson, first down. I should say second down. They put him in to try to pick the first down up. That was Alden Smith, number 85. He's a redshirt freshman out of Raytown, Missouri, and number 85, been very active in the defensive front here so far for the Tigers.
Isn't it amazing how much better you look as a quarterback when the offensive line is coming off the ball and allowing you to run the football? The backs are running with some authority, and Fozzie Whitaker and Cody Johnson, some receivers outside of Shipley, are making some plays. I mean, this is a complete team effort. It's not just Colt McCoy completing 11 out of 11. The entire offense has taken it up a notch.
Option. McCoy has a crease, and so he takes it upfield as we take a look at the Pacific Life game summary. And as you might expect, the Horns are dominating in the numbers, too, with 193 overall yards, Herbie, to 26 for Mizzou.
And the other stat that you and I are keeping track of is, when will Missouri cross midfield? That still is yet to happen here in the first half.
Protected pocket holds, and there's the first incompletion of the night. 11 of 12, Fozzie Whitaker, and in case you just joined us, 9 o'clock in the East. McCoy nearly perfect, 11 of 12 here tonight. Texas has had the ball for 3 possessions in the first quarter. They scored on all 3. Missouri has been unable to cross the 50-yard line. The number 3 team in the nation dominating on both ends of the ball here. Third down and 7. Underneath, but that'll be short of a first down. Now, for the first time tonight, we should see the Texas punter, as Malcolm Williams was short of the first down.
And that time, you see Baston here limping off, but he actually did a good job of fighting off Chris Hall and fighting through a double team to try to get to Colt McCoy, and force Colt McCoy to leave that pocket a little prematurely.
Tucker will punt, and Geddes standing back just inside the Tigers 20. Low bouncing punt fielded by Geddes, and down he goes at the 19-yard line. So we'll take a timeout. It is 21-0 Longhorns. You're watching Saturday. See the leaves out at Rockbridge State Park. Glorious sunshine. Everybody enjoyed meeting up with their old friends down at Shakespeare's, getting a pizza here. That's one of the great pizza places in college football. Now, they were going to have a little trickeration, and finally, Alexander tosses it to nowhere. I mean, the Horns read it perfectly.
It's a great job by the discipline here of Shockey Brown, the corner, who's going to stay on his man the entire way. Missouri is known for a little trickeration. One thing that you have to be prepared for is staying back. And number 8 that time just waited, stayed back, kept everything in front of him, and they didn't fool anybody on that play.
Second and 10. See number 2, Kendall, moving around on the right side of that defensive front. And they run away from it for a first and 10 plus some. And that's the freshman, Kendall Lawrence, the freshman from Rockwall, Texas. And it looks like we may see a little bit more of him tonight.
And also,
that's a 22-yard gain.
Yes, sir. And great block there. Missouri showing a little bit of a different look with 2 backs in the backfield. Derek Washington picks up a good block that time on McElroy to give the young back more room to run.
David Yost telling us that he probably, Herbie, would have to use 2 backs here tonight to protect Gabbert as much as anything else. And that time, I think the Horns read pass, and they ran out. Ran very well. Throwing that little bubble screen off to the side, out to the 45-yard line that time with Denario Alexander, the senior from Marlin, Texas. Well, Earl Thomas makes the stop.
Against pressure in this conference, best way to slow it down is to slow defensive linemen down by throwing the bubble screen and being able to establish that running game. That's how you get the defense to slow down, and all of a sudden you get back to trying to run the basics of your offense.
So Gabbert has completed 4 of 9, all 4 to Alexander tonight for 34 yards. And there's the first completion away from Alexander that time. And that was Jackson, and there's a penalty flag. First down, waved that penalty off.
I was excited because they got across midfield there for the first time. Not only a first down, now Missouri's got it going a little bit here.
First down and 10, the ball at the 47-yard line. Lawrence has been impressive. They come back with Washington. Let's check in down below with Lisa.
Well, Brent, as you know, Denario.
Look at the list of injuries that Denario has suffered. Once upon a time here, he was listed above Jeremy Maclin in the depth chart. That's right. That's how good a prospect he was before the injury bug struck. And they're coming back with Lawrence again. And just to give you an idea, go back to 2007 and take a look down now at the offense. How's that? Jeremy was a redshirt freshman out of the St. Louis area, now playing with the Philadelphia Eagles. You'll see him on Monday night. And that's how fine a prospect Alexander was at that time.
The injuries that he has had to overcome even tells you that much more about his determination and where he is today compared to where he was when he was listed ahead of Jeremy Maclin.
Third down and 3 for the Tigers. First down, and Lawrence, the freshman, picks it up to the 31-yard line. So the youngster from Texas doing a job.
And the line right now starting to push people around. Curtis Gregory, Dan Hope coming around. There's quick hitters. All of a sudden, I think they're catching this Texas defense. It's bending back a little bit, and they're taking control up front. But that time, Gregory and Hope both coming around, pulling, open that big hole up. And Lawrence, his quickness, I think, right now is catching Texas off guard.
21-0 lead will do that.
Yeah.
Teams relax, sit back a little bit, need to get it all ramped up. Mizzou mounts a rally here with a first and 10. Gabbert picks up another 7 yards, and he hit Wes Kemp, a sophomore from St. Louis. Here is that offensive line that Herbie referred to. And right there at the right guard, Curtis Gregory. Grew up a little over an hour from here on a farm. Self-described farm boy, and Lisa was enamored with his stories of counting pigs and figuring out which one are going to go to market for pops. She liked that story so much she went out and had some pork chops last night. Second down and 3. And breaking free is Derek Washington, and this an impressive drive by the Tigers here tonight.
Gregory on that right side, he and Dan Hoke again, a double team, and look at the block there. He goes right off of the back of 77 Hoke, but it started with Gregory and Hoke. They pulled the previous play, this time creating a wall to give that time Derek Washington plenty of room in the backside. And they're not just making plays here, they're opening up huge running lanes for these running backs.
Now a first and 10. Of course, in the red zone for the first time tonight. In fact, in Texas territory for the first time on this drive. Trailing by 3 touchdowns and coming back with Washington. And it is the running game that has brought them down the field behind that offensive line.
Derek Washington, along with Kendall Lawrence, really giving them a nice 1-2 punch on this drive. 10 plays now is 78 Curtis Gregory and the bunch up front. I think for the first time all game in rhythm right now, and on this drive playing with a lot of confidence.
Washington, the running back, with Gabbert. Here he comes, and the front is ready for him. This will be third down. Lamar Houston there.
Houston. No
game. So here's your third down and 7. Gabbert figures to put it up. If Gabbert was healthy, he would be a threat to run in this situation. He is a big man who can move. But here he is back in the gun, the 12th play, and undoubtedly, because of that injured ankle, he'll be looking for a receiver. He'll lob it toward the end zone, jump ball, and touchdown, Missouri. Jared Perry, the senior from Texas, makes the grab, and Missouri is on the board here tonight, working against Shockey Brown.
I'm wondering here if he goes out of bounds. He looks like he's pushed out of bounds by Shockey Brown.
He was out of bounds.
Definitely out of bounds, but he came back, and I think there the officials have to determine whether or not he's pushed, and did he make an effort to get back in bounds after the catch. Or before,
instant
right before
replay has stopped it upstairs.
The play is under further review.
Instant replay will take a look at this.
Ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
So Missouri's on the scoreboard. Gabbert with his first touchdown pass, and the one thing about Gabbert, if you haven't seen it, he can make the downfield throws. Russell adds the extra point. And Missouri moves back to within 14. Timeout. Time now for the Kirk Herbstreit Aflac question of the night. All right, who was number one in the first release of the BCS standings? First time they ever came out. Back in 1998.
I'm going to say.
Think about that. Clock is ticking now. We're going to bring it back fast. It's going to be the lightning round tonight. That's Jim Cramer's one. We have a lightning round. We're going to bring it back right after the kickoff. I'm going to show you the answer. All right, here we go now. 21-7. Mills will kick it away. Fielded at the four by Monroe. Right straight up the middle. There's a bit of a seam when he's down at the 30. All right, Harry. Time's up now. 1998. Oh, they'll march off. Here it comes.
All right, 97, we had split championship.
Right.
I'm going to say Nebraska.
Time's up.
Nebraska.
Look at this answer.
Wow.
How about that one?
Cade McNown in the Bruins.
UCLA.
Yeah.
Was the first number one flat question. Herbie, that was a tough one.
You know, can I add to it?
Sure.
You probably involved somewhere. I think you were calling the Kansas State game.
Absolutely.
Against A&M. But that last Saturday in the BCS standings, UCLA lost to Miami. Kansas State ended up beating A&M and then allowed Tennessee. A&M ended up beating Kansas State. And Tennessee ended up going to the national title and beating Florida State that year.
Nice hand. Colt McCoy pulls it down. Wide open is his buddy Shipley. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
All of a sudden, Missouri scores. So what are you going to do? You're going to try to find your man. And again, they continue to give Jordan Shipley a free release off the line of scrimmage. He will take that. Thank you very much. And Colt McCoy is 13 of 14 and already 5 receptions to Jordan Shipley.
First down and 10 for McCoy. Woke this Texas team back up. There's Goodwin, the sprinter. Picking up 7 yards. Let's go quickly to Matt for another update. Matt, that's a typical Hawkeye game. They win games in the fourth quarter. You should know that by now. Second down, and here's McCoy. And Fozzie Whitaker, the ball carrier, picks up the first down.
Whitaker, the ball carrier.
Well, it's nice to see Texas having this phase within their offense, because it just seems to, like any offense, it opens up so much more. But Fozzie Whitaker, and the door opened up for him last week with the injuries to Vondrell McGee and Trey Newton. He's finally healthy, and there's a difference with number 28 in this lineup, because they thought when Jamal Charles left early that Whitaker would have been their guy last year, but he's just been dinged up.
Coming in underneath, and that's Greg Smith, the tight end, rumbling for 9 yards.
I like to see the big fella get a chance to catch the ball. But Greg Smith has lost so much weight to be able to be a tight end where they can go out there and make some plays, throw the football. They've decided with Greg Davis now, instead of going with that four wide receiver look all the time, they want to incorporate a tight end and one running back and three receivers more to be able to establish the run and do better job in pass protection.
Catch car gave him no respect. High and incomplete. Malcolm Williams. Well, coming up on the Capital One Halftime Report, John and Jesse will have all the day's big highlights, and there's some major stories going on. Mississippi State playing number one tough. Alabama surviving against Tennessee. Notre Dame winning again in a close one, finally snapping that losing streak at the hands of BC. All those stories are coming up at halftime. Of course, next week with Oregon winning big on Halloween night, they will be hosting USC in Eugene. Third down and one. Option look. McCoy, first down, slides safely to the 37.
Slides safely. It was an official slide there. Good block on the outside. Ulatowski, Smith involved there. And there's just enough of a seam there that Colt McCoy has good patience, breaks that little bit of an arm tackle, and picks up a first down. You know, a lot of Colt McCoy's throws tonight have been short, up close to the line of scrimmage. I think you and I are sensing the same thing. Eventually, he's going to get downfield.
Got a man on the sideline. Williams dropped it. Oh, that was a gimme, folks, on that far side.
Well, that's been the thing that has held Malcolm Williams back from being the guy, is just consistency of catching the football. I think that time he starts to take a little bit of a peek there at Kenja Jackson instead of focusing and making the catch. It's one of those things that eventually, for Malcolm to become a consistent playmaker and have his chances, he's got to eliminate that aspect from his game.
McCoy now 15 of 18 for 169 yards and two touchdowns. Second down and 10. Drops a screen off to Fozzie Whitaker. Whitaker breaks free to the 20-yard line.
Well, the sophomore, there's no doubt about it, has brought just a different feel to the offense with him in that backfield. It adds another difference maker to go along with Jordan Shipley. We keep talking about the growth of this offense. Who wants to join Shipley? It looks like Whitaker does. And eventually, you got to believe Marquise Goodwin can join in as well.
Johnson alongside McCoy. And Williams this time makes the catch and then tiptoes down the sideline. See where it is marked that he was out of bounds, but again, with receivers like that, you put it in their hands and you're off them that far, and they're going to be downfield for 10, 12 yards before you get them out of bounds.
Yep, big cushion there. Malcolm Williams one-on-one. If he catches the football, you know what he can do, and he's got four catches on a night. Look at the way they're spreading the football around tonight. 17 receptions, and you can see the backs are involved, and those receivers are making a lot of plays.
First down and goal. Had to reach back, steps away from the rush, and he's sacked. It all began with a little bit of an errant snap. Smith will be credited with the tackle.
Nice catch, though, by Colt McCoy. One hands it off to his right. And after that, I think it definitely affected the rhythm and the flow of that play. Also, Missouri did a good job of finally getting some penetration from the outside. And Alden Smith, young freshman, is very, very athletic, and you could see that eventually he's going to be quite a pass rush specialist for this Missouri Tiger defense.
Second down and goal. Clock ticking inside of 2 minutes here in the first half. McCoy, touchdown, Shipley, his second touchdown of the night, and McCoy's third. McCoy goes over 200 yards here in the first half, 18 of 21, and now three touchdowns.
Now, poor Carl Geddes gets left on an island against Shipley. Look at the line of scrimmage to the right. Boom! Just a quick little move to the outside, and then he goes to the inside. And there are not very many corners in college football that are left walked up in bump coverage against Jordan Shipley. They're going to survive without a safety behind them. Great throw again by McCoy. He's definitely feeling it tonight.
This is by far Colt McCoy's best half throwing the football of the season. Back to a three-touchdown advantage. Colt McCoy jumping back into that Heisman Trophy race here tonight in Columbia, Missouri. Defensive back Carl Geddes having a tough night. He and Dev Steckel, the defensive coordinator, get into it for just a few moments over there on the far sideline. And Herbie, what's your feeling about players talking back to coaches when they come off the field?
The emotions are flying high. You get embarrassed like that, you're always going to be upset. But when a coach is talking to you, maybe I'm old school, I believe you look him in the eye and you listen to him, and you take for whatever it's worth, you listen to it, and then you feel differently, you walk away. But you always got to sit there and listen to your coach.
tries to return it that time. So that was Lawrence and not Simmons. Well, the chase now, the halfway point. Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon will try to close that gap on Jimmy Johnson. They go to Martinsville, one of the great old tracks. Coverage begins on ABC at 1 Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific, presented by Goodyear. There you see the ageless one, Mark Martin, trailing Jimmy by 90 points. Jimmy Johnson trying to four-peat in the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup. An unbelievable performance in the last few years by Jimmy Johnson, whose teammate, of course, is Jeff Gordon.
Missouri needs to be careful. I know they want to try to get points here, but you cannot turn the football over.
They'll try Lawrence, their freshman running back, again. Well, MetLife providing today's aerial coverage. Visit MetLife.com to learn more about MetLife's long history of providing coverage at major sporting events.
Second down and 14.
Second down and 14 coming up for Gabbard and the Tigers. Final minute 15 here of the first half. An impressive drive a few minutes ago by Missouri, but Colt McCoy and the horns answer. They've been stopped only one time here tonight. Texas with 285 yards of offense. Trying to run it wide now with Moore.
Matt Brown should call a timeout here. He still has a minute to go. He's got two timeouts left, and they are. They're going to use it over their timeouts. I mean, Missouri's just trying to get out of here, down 28-7, and Mac Brown's, he's trying to attack this whole first half. So maintaining that attitude, he gets the timeout, still has one to go, and he can use it after this to force the punt.
And so he will bring him over with 58 seconds to go, up 28-7. And I think the point is, we've talked about Alabama surviving. Well, guess what? Florida's going to have to survive. They are tied right now with Mississippi State in Starkville. So the Horns are trying to accomplish a lot here tonight, and to try and move up in the eyes of the computers and the voters and all of that that determines the BCS.
And this subjective BCS, that matters. Remember, absolutely, Texas fans have been so frustrated over the last few years about Mac Brown, why don't you run up the score? And he always defends himself and says he's got a lot of respect. And I think he does respect his peers and his colleagues. But in this case, they're just out playing football. And they have brought their A game tonight. Clearly, he got the message across that he doesn't want them to have a letdown after the Oklahoma game. I've been impressed. It's one half of football, but I've been thoroughly impressed with Mac Brown's ball club tonight.
He's got third and 14. Stop here. We'll get it back for a few seconds. Gabbert in the end zone, in trouble. Finally gets it off with Houston closing off. In on him. So now there's 51 seconds left on the clock. By using that timeout, with the incomplete pass,
right, still has
that
his
stops
time
the clock, and he can come back down the field now.
You give Colt McCoy and his offense the ball at the very least at midfield, probably going to be in Missouri territory with Shipley back there returning this punt, and he still has a timeout. Texas is thinking 35-7 before half. What was the score last year at halftime? 35-3 or 35-0? 35-3.
There's Harry. And it's blocked. Blocked by the Longhorns. Touchdown. Texas picks up a touchdown. One of the things that Mac Brown's staff does not get enough credit for is the performance of their special teams. We rave about schools like Virginia Tech. Texas will take a backseat to nobody. Nobody. As they roll in, there were three protectors, and they come in and block it in the end zone, recovered for a Texas touchdown.
Well, Harry that time walked right into Curtis Brown. He comes off to his left here. Right, Harry, Curtis Brown says, thank you very much for coming off to your left there.
Malcolm Williams recovers that one for the touchdown. 35-7 Texas. Well, the weather has been beautiful, but the game not going the way the alums would like here today. Homecoming weekend, and some of the students, they've got a great, great student body here, support this team loyally, and they will continue to support them no matter what happens tonight. But it is tough sledding here And as we close out the first half, Kirby, our man Kenny Chesney, is he down in the islands?
He's down in the islands, celebrating his dad's birthday. So we want to wish Dave Chesney, a happy birthday as they enjoy a little relaxation.
Yeah, Kenny, write us a new tune. Second half of the season. Well, on Tuesday, November 3rd at 8. November 3rd. Man, next Saturday, Halloween, huh? Trick or treat and all of that. Wow. That could be so. I bet your kids, they got the costumes, and they're all set.
They're wound up, ready to go.
That neighborhood of yours, that'll be good.
Exactly.
I may go there and put a mask on trick or treat your neighborhood. I can see the beats out there. So, here we go, the final seconds. Ticking away here. Hey, your Buckeyes back in Columbus, a little bit of life today.
Terrell Pryor looked like he ended up having a decent day throwing the football. And Jim Tressel, they put up 38 today, right?
Yeah. So final seconds will tick away here in the first half. And the Longhorns, remember what McCoy said at the top of our broadcast. We start from the beginning tonight. We play the first half.
This team
fired up Colt McCoy, 18 of 21 in the first half for 213 yards and 3 touchdowns. Let's go down to Lisa with Coach Mack Brown.
Thanks, Brent. Mack, Colt McCoy and Jordan Shipley, they got in rhythm early with the first play of the game. What is really clicking with them tonight?
Lisa, I think that since we've got all the compliments in now to the offense, they're much more confident. We've got more balance with our run and pass, and I'm seeing the Colt that we saw last year.
Now, you guys seem to be trying to set the tone early. You had that fake punt at midfield. You've got 35 points on the board. We've talked about the importance of style points. At what point do you maybe think about taking your foot off the gas a little bit?
Well, when Missouri has got an offense like Texas Tech and they're 1 minute all over the field, you can't ever stop. You got to keep scoring, got to keep playing, and you've got to be more aggressive on the road because upsets happen on the road. We got to take care of the football. There's only the one turnover, and it was the blocked punt, but we've got to keep playing.
So not now.
No, ma'am. We're going to go ahead and start this game over. We got to restart it like it's nothing.
All right, thank you, Matt.
All right, Lisa. Well, folks, stay tuned for the Capital One Halftime Report. You know who's coming up. Big John Saunders and Smooth Jesse Palmer. They'll have a lot of great stories coming your way after this.